You call my name, and I ran out of that grave, out of the darkness into your glorious day.
Good morning and welcome to the Vine Church. If you're visiting with us this morning, we want to give you an especially warm welcome. Why not say hello to us in the comments box below and let us know where you're watching from.
So this morning we're just going to begin with a scripture from 1 John chapter 1. It says this: "This is the message that we have heard from him and declare to you, God is light, in him there is no darkness at all. If we claim to have fellowship with him and yet walk in the darkness, we lie and do not live out the truth. But if we walk in the light as he is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his son, purifies us from all sin." We're just going to pray this morning before we begin our service. Thank you, Lord God, that we can live in your light every day of our lives. I pray that today that you would shine your light on everyone watching and that we might hear and receive from you today. Amen.
Amen. We're going to go over to some worship now.
Stars, they wept. The morning sun was dead. The Savior of the world was falling. His body on the cross, his blood poured out for us. The weight of every curse upon him.
Darkness, the battle in the grave.
Welcome back, everyone. We've just got a few announcements for this coming week ahead. So first of all, on Tuesday we have our prayer meeting, Pray As You Go. That's on Tuesday morning at 10:30 a.m. Everyone is welcome. If you're not used to coming along to that, then please PM us and we'll get the code to you.
On Thursday evening at 7 p.m. we have our Bible study. It's about the Holy Spirit and the believer. Everyone's welcome, even if you didn't make it last week. Again, have a look on WhatsApp for the code for that.
Okay, and then finally, just after the service, we have our coffee and communion on Zoom. Again, everyone is welcome to that. So if you're visiting today, then please PM us and we'd love to send you the code or email us and we will get that to you. See you soon.
Before I took a breath, you were
Good morning, it's really great to be with you, and thank you for joining with us this morning. I wonder if you're notorious for anything. If you ask anyone who knows me, they will likely say that I'm notorious for losing my keys. The other thing which frequently goes wrong is that I often forget my keys. There's nothing worse for me when I'm well on my way to work, some 25 miles away, and I discover I've forgotten them. As it happened to me the other day. I was well out of the house and I had to go all the way back again. I wonder what reaction you would have if you did something like that. Mine is usually one of extreme frustration. Let me ask you a question this morning. Are you a half glass full person or a half glass empty one? Today we're going to continue our new series called Transformed. Last week we looked at how to be transformed in the workplace and considered how we might grow in the workplace when we approach it with the correct way or in the correct way. Now this week I want to continue in the same vein with the title Transformed Attitudes. A good attitude is important in everything we do, and it's up to us to choose what kind of attitude we want to embrace. We can wake up each morning dreading what lies ahead, or we can wake up thanking God and thankful all for the blessings that we enjoy, but sometimes we take for granted. You see, our mindset affects what kind of day we might have, and it can either make us productive and happy or unproductive and miserable. And deliberately maintaining a godly attitude can change our entire outlook on life and give us amazing results of blessing and fruitfulness. We may not be able to control the things that go on about us, but we can control how we perceive them. In the Bible, Paul suffered hardship and persecution, but he still chose to be content in all circumstances. We don't have to let external situations dictate how we feel inside. And when we guard our hearts and refuse to allow negative thoughts to fester inside us, we control the direction of our lives. In Proverbs chapter 4 verse 23 it says this, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life." Now here's some false attitudes that can govern our lives. We might say, well, that's just me, that's just the way I am. What we are saying is I'm determined, there's nothing I can do about it. We may also say, well, they make me so mad. What we're saying is I'm not responsible. My emotional life is governed by someone else or something else outside of my control. We may also say, I can't do that. I just don't have time. So we're saying that something or someone is limiting me and controlling me. We may also say, well, if they were only more patient or gentle. You know, and what we're saying by that is someone or someone else's behaviour is limiting my effectiveness. And finally, we might even say this, I'm the one who has to do it all. And so what we're saying there is, I am not free to choose my own actions. See, you can choose your attitude. At our wedding, we had to choose our own attitude because the week before there was a split in the church. And it was a difficult situation. We were getting into the happiest day of our lives, but there was factions in the church which were opposing each other, and it was a difficult time. But we had to choose to go through that with the best attitude possible. You know, when you're hurt by someone, you can choose your attitude. You might be deeply offended, but you can choose still. Every day of our lives, we choose our attitude towards our leadership, towards the boss at work, towards the next door neighbour, the children, our parents, our friends. You only have to look at the royal family today, right at this moment, to see how some attitudes are outplayed in the public arena by Prince Harry and his wife, to see how some attitudes can be quite destructive. Eleanor Roosevelt said this, "No one can hurt you without your consent." Whenever someone has a hold over you, they also have control over you. Who has control over your life today? Philippians chapter 2 verse 1 says this, and this is our key scripture for today. If you have any encouragement from being united with Christ, if any comfort from his love, if any fellowship with the Spirit, if any tenderness and compassion, then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility consider others better than yourselves. Each of you should not only look to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Your attitude should be the same as Christ Jesus, who, being in the very nature of God, did not consider equality with God something to be grasped, but made himself nothing, taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every other name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, and on in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Amen. And that's a good scripture, isn't it? This whole passage is so outward looking. It deals with a Christ who submits to his own destiny and purpose and will of God. There was a reception held honouring the musician Sir Robert Mayer on his 100th birthday. And at this reception, Lady Diana Cooper fell into conversation with a friendly woman who seemed to know her really well. But her failing eyesight prevented her from recognising her fellow guest until she peered more closely at the magnificent diamonds round her neck, and she realised she was talking to Queen Elizabeth. Overcome with embarrassment, Lady Diana curtsied and she stammered, "Ma'am, I am so sorry, I didn't recognise you without your crown." And she replied, "It was so much Sir Robert's evening that I decided to leave it behind." You see, what is the ultimate key to having a good attitude? It's having humility. When Jesus became the servant of all, he did one significant thing. He took the crown off and he laid it aside. Now, isn't that the mark of a true servant? Someone who takes the crown off. Now, here's a couple of crowns that we might need to take off. We might need to take off the crown of pride, which says, "I'm too big for this, I'm too spiritual or too manly." The crown of stubbornness, that's about digging our heels in into every circumstance, whether or not it's a good one or not. And then there's the crown of negativity, you know, so we have nothing good to say about anything. Or, you know, see, the level of humility attained by Jesus was that he laid down the crown, his heavenly crown. There are people who go around fault finding, the crown of fault finding. Some people make it their mission in life. But Paul, in this passage, he considers further here that unity brings a couple of key assets to the church. He's basically challenging us to come out of it with the right attitude. He says that being united with Christ should find an expression in love, an expression in fellowship, and then an expression in compassion. All good attitudes to have. Paul then says, if all of this is to be accomplished, then your attitude, my attitude, needs to be the same as Christ Jesus. You see, in any given moment, we can choose our attitude, but if we profess to be the people that we claim to be, does that attitude reflect the character of Jesus Christ? The sinful nature is clear, and it often governs the nature of our thinking. Basically, sometimes our attitude to other people stinks, doesn't it? If we were really honest inside in our hearts, we can often get very self-righteous about our own attitude and become that stumbling block to unity. How do we do this? Well, by not promoting self. See, Jesus used everything to his advantage. He was all about the Father's business. This humility, Jesus humbled himself even to death on a cross. And then there's valuing other people above ourselves. See, I like that because what we value, we cherish, we take care of. I really like this. See, Jesus was the master of his own destiny. By submitting his will to the Father, ensured that the plan was in place. The map for his life was in place. We ourselves are masters of our own destiny in this context, in the kingdom of heaven, that we can choose which way to go within it. It's so easy to harbour attitudes that are grown, that we have grown to become part of our characters. And I believe it's true when they say that your attitude determines your altitude. Let me say that again. Your attitude determines your altitude. Viktor Frankl says, he was a concentration camp survivor, and he said this: everything can be taken from a man but one thing. To choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's way. So Christopher Wren was supervising the construction of St Paul's Cathedral in London, and a journalist thought it would be interesting to interview some of the workers, so he chose three of them. And he asked them this question: what are you doing? And the first replied, I'm cutting stone for 10 shillings a day. And the next answered, I'm putting in 10 hours a day on this job. But the third said, I'm helping Sir Christopher Wren construct one of London's greatest cathedrals. What are you constructing in your daily life? Whose business are you about? Who are you helping to meet their goals today? What kind of attitude do you have, an outlook of life and to life? So what does an attitude to Christ Jesus look like in this passage? Jesus had an unselfish attitude. So we are not to live to make a good impression, but to care about the interests of others in verses 3 and 4 of that passage. Jesus also had a servant attitude in verse 7. Jesus came to earth and took the form of a servant, even though Jesus was God in human form. Jesus had a sacrificial attitude in our passage. Jesus, of course, was made the ultimate sacrifice, his life. He, as believers, we are to give of ourselves to help others, to sacrifice ourselves. Jesus also had a humble attitude in verse 8. It says, Christ humbled himself and became obedient. And then in verse 3, we have to think of others as better than ourselves in verse 3 there. So Jesus also had an obedient attitude. Christ became obedient to the point of death. And then back to verse 8 again, God gives us the desire to obey him and the power to do what pleases him. A chaplain was once speaking to a soldier in a hospital, and he says, you have lost an arm in the great cause. And said the soldier with a smile, he says, I didn't lose it, I gave it. In that same way, Jesus did not lose his life, but he purposely gave it for you and I. So tomorrow morning when you get up, how can you get into the day with a great attitude? Here's a couple of pointers. Number one, you need to take charge of your thought life. Philippians chapter 4 verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about such things. Whatever you have learned or received or heard from me or seen in me, put it into practice. Paul was saying, look at the attitude I have and go that way. Look at the attitude of Christ and go that way. Why not start every day in your thought life with a verse for the day, a Bible passage, or a prayer time with a friend? Put your own spiritual life in pole position and don't allow the TV or work or problems or outside influence to dictate the pace of your day. If there's any negative thoughts, the Bible says that we need to take captive every thought and make it obedient to Christ. This verse tells me that I have the option to influence my day rather than have it influence me. Secondly, respond rather than react to circumstances. John Maxwell says this: circumstances do not make you what you are, they reveal what you are. As things come our way during the day, we have a choice to respond or react. Response means that our decisions and therefore our actions are measured in life. But reaction often has destructive tendencies. It centres around impatience for things, lashing out at people, getting grumpy about this, getting angry about that, whatever it might be. Proverbs chapter 15 says this: a gentle answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. Remember, you're not responsible for anyone else's attitude but yourself. We cannot control circumstances of others or their actions, but we can take charge of our own. Thirdly, you need to be accountable for your life. The Bible says if we confess our sins, He is faithful and He is just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Keeping a short account of your life is a great start, because with His forgiveness comes a cleansing of our lives. So therefore, we go into each day clean with a good attitude, prepared for the day. But this must be extended to other people. We need to keep a short account with them also. If we don't, then what happens is we will lay the foundation of both pride and rebellion. Both of these things will fester and lay the groundwork for bad attitudes towards God and others later on. Number four, prepare for the unexpected. In all walks of life, change happens. The computer fails, you lose your job, relationships fail, friends pass away, you forget your keys. There is nothing that you will face today that God does not already know about. Your life does not come as a surprise to Him. Not one iota. You see, preparing for the unexpected means that we submit ourselves to God. You need to know that your circumstance will not bend God one inch. Philippians 4 verse 6 again, do not be anxious about anything, but in every situation by prayer and petition, with thanksgiving, present your requests to God. And the peace of God, which transcends all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. You see, when we have got our attitude and heart right with God, then our hearts are at peace with Him. Our hearts are settled, and therefore we already have a good attitude. So stressing about a change or circumstance or changing circumstance will not change that circumstance. You might as well learn to trust God for your life now. And finally, number five, look for someone to bless every day. Pray that God will use you for His love to flow through you into the lives of other people. Every day, make the most of the opportunities that God gives you to inspire other people and to develop positive attitudes by loving them, by serving them through both what you say and what you do.
I believe. and I sing. Jesus, I believe in you. Jesus, I belong to you. The reason that I live, the reason that I sing, with all I am.
Well, hi everyone. Thank you so much for joining with us today at the Vine Church. If you would like to know more about us, then please check out our Facebook page, our Instagram, our Twitter, or even our webpage. We'd love to connect with you. Please join us now for our Zoom meeting, coffee and communion. Everyone is welcome, as we said before. Please PM us for the code if you don't have it. We'd love to see you there. Bye now.
You call my name, and I